Perfect. Now let's see where we're at today. So we pushed some docks last night off stream. Entity proxy. Ah, here we are. So we were trying to get build a test suite to do things, so I didn't have to manually test. Interesting song. So let's dive into that. Where were we at with that? Well, I suppose we can just run it and see what happens. No name. Okay. S1.listen, S2. Ugh. Well, we can get rid of these to begin with, because that is incorrect. Because that takes a slightly different protocol. Acetation error. Connection refused. Connecting to on self.instance. That actually indicates we've got another issue. There we go. That should be an F string. Because if you have a look here, and we go to... I can get my key bindings correct. Oh, screw it. Have a look at that. That should have been substituted with a value, which if we do it again, there we go. And if I run it every single time, it should be non-deterministic because I'm using random. Yeah, perfect. Now the question is, do we have a timing issue? We could possibly have one. So outgoing then listen. Yes, we definitely do. So we're actually trying to connect, because at the moment the scheduling is deterministic. I know it's trying to establish the outgoing connection before the listening connection is even set up. So let's swap that around. And if we have a look here, outgoing makes a socket and then tries and connects. So that's only one round trip. And then the listen, self lock await. That also only takes one round trip, which is good. So that means just by reordering this will work. If say S2.listen took two syscalls to establish its connection, then I would have to delay outgoing because this would execute once, then this would execute once, but because this hadn't executed twice, we'd run into an issue. So all good. Now this won't work, but key error. Get item, routing table. I need to see more of the stack trace, I think. I want to see how far through the process we are. So, that's good. Okay, so it's a routing table inside. Inside the main loop. I'm still questioning if I want to be doing, if I want to actually put that there, but I have to, right? Task send. At task send, I have to look up where everything is, so it has to be embedded in that. That's fine, okay. But what we can do here, nice little trick. Now I've got a debugger. So if we go self, zero items. Now that's interesting. Or actually, you know what? I should realize that because the only time a key error ever gets raised with a routing table is if there's no entries. Because it is a ring, as long as there is one entry, it should wrap around back to the original item. So I've obviously got to update this. Now the question is, how do I do that? I don't have to calculate the key because I can just insert any key and there's only one remote. So I don't have to implement the full routing table or gossip protocol. That's good. but I do have to know the destination address, and luckily I can calculate that, because if we go back to our test here, you can see I've got S1 and S2, so it's very, very easy for me to just go, hey, localhost port, blah, 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 blah. And in fact, I'm going to change this up and go remote receiver address. And we're going to call this one the sender ADR. Do, 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 do. And then we can just go sender ADR S1 is equal to 2 is equal to receive. There we go, that's looking better. Bum, bum, bum. Bum, 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 bum. Okay, so that should maintain compatibility with that. But now I can just quickly call these. I mean, I could have just done the tuple again, but you know why? It's more than likely I'll refactor this later and screw everything up. So we can actually now insert into the routing table. Now, what do I have to do here? Comment it, because this is going to be something I'm going to forget later. Receiver needs to live in the routing table. As we are not getting a reply back, we do this manually. So we do not need to do something to implement gossip. Awesome. I was gonna just do X0 or the null byte, but I can actually just do the empty one. Is equal to receive ADDR. Now, I have to be careful here because I can't remember if this is actually supposed to take an entity object or an address. Now, this is where it gets kind of funny, right? Because the receiver address is actually embedded in the entity's identity. Wow, that is really, really confusing when you say it out loud. But anyway, we're not talking about the entity state. If it had been the state, it would have been a problem because the connection could be closed, in which case everything needs to be rebuilt and the state needs to be rebuilt, and that could cause problems. So I'm inclined to believe that the remote address is what we want. Sender address. But I don't know if all the... if everything's aligned properly to allow that at this point. So I think I want to end up with an entity address in there in the end. But for the moment, we're just going to use the raw... Yes, we do want the entity address because we want to be able to switch between IPv4 and IPv6. But for the moment, we're going to cheat. So we'll just put an address tuple in there. Bum, bum, bum. Now this won't raise a key error, but it's going to do something completely different. And I could work out what that's going to be, but it's probably just going to be quicker to run it and let it fail. Unsupported address. Entity address in a tuple. Really? Entity address. Yes, that is actually correct. Because an entity address already has the instance in it, and I'm specifying an address of an address, which is incorrect. Ugh. Oh, man. You think you're doing well sleep-wise, and then you actually go off and do something, and you realize you're half asleep. So let's dig into this a bit further. Let's also inspect the local state, because there's some interesting stuff here, and I want to see what it looks like. So you can see our syscall we're sending to S2S localhost blah. The message is listen. Routing. Why are we sending the routing table? Listen, routing table. Because this is a setup code. And listen needs a routing table because it can't be part of the object state because it's changed every single time. Okay. I've only got one task running at the moment. And the current running task is that task. As you can see, the addresses match up. Instance. Raised in representation. Sender object. So this might be a second bug, which does not bode well for my confidence. Instance, sender object. No, that's correct, because this. Yeah, that makes sense. So let's see, where are we at in the code? We're actually in the main loop. Crap. This is going to be one of these ones that's hard to diagnose and debug. So we put an entity address there. So what is node? Node address entity. So address is actually an entity address and tuple. So that line is likely incorrect, which is fine because I know this part of the code was some of the first written and not tested. And then I wrote the implementation for the message routing separately and independently without considering what was here. So let's dig into this a bit further, I think. Which line are we on? Come on, don't do this to me. $285. Really not. Really, really not thinking through correctly here. So. I need to note what nodes is. So node is the address. So this is what I was talking about with the routing table. Demonstrate it back in the here. What do I chuck here into the routing table? Is it the address tuple or is it this? Now, under normal circumstances, it would be this because it'd be like a dot send and I just send it and it magically appears at the other end because there's a proxy. But we don't have that. We've got a receiver-focused API rather than a sender-focused API. And most of the design of this is actually sender-focused. So I'm going to have to change the code there. Easy as pie. We actually change this. Well, actually, where's address come from? If address is an entity, address always ends up being an entity address. Not, okay. If it's an entity, gets address, it's address. So that's encoded in the send. And we've got two separate addresses here, right? We've got the address where the message wants to, so the address of the other entity we're sending to. And then from the routing table, we pull the network level address. And that seems like where the confusion is coming from. So if node is not self, then it's going remote. So this code here needs to be fixed. Sender destination task. Okay. So destination task tasks and make instance. Sender. So this is actually slightly different. If node is not self, in fact, that actually seems like it's a bug. Yeah, there. This is actually does have a bug. The node in the cluster should have hashed itself and added it to the table. So, so there we go. That's that. Now, network address here, the type of this is actually, well, optional. Tuple string int. Now, that's for IPv4 addresses. IPv6, of course, the tuple is actually 5 elements long because you have the flow ID in it. But that's fine for now. Now, the reason it's optional means that this is a nullable type. And self is actually null, or none in Python parlance. So let's drop that back down because I actually don't need that annotation. Is not self. So I do need, well, you know what? If I add myself to it, then the routing could be incorrect. But that actually, now that I think about it, that's fine because I'm over, it depends on where I set the null, right? So if I, options.listen, neighbors, self. Okay, so that actually does get added. So if I'm invoking via command line, the each instance does get added as one would expect. That's just because I'm testing that the routing table is empty. Okay, that's actually what the behavior we want. Oh, stretch. Might just move the camera down a bit. I'm also trying to procrastinate as much as possible here. So, I am trying to work out how to say that name. Cenobite Offsec. That's nice and confusing. Thanks for the follow. If you've got any questions, just feel free to ask. This is mainly an open mic and a way to actually get me to make progress on this because I've been procrastinating on this code all week and it's been driving me absolutely nuts. This is not actually, some of this code and the concepts seem simple, but a lot of the subtlety is in the details. Subtlety is in the details? Or something like that. It's deceptively simple. Turns out it's actually not, so. So we need to be sending to the correct thing. So node is network address at, I know it's S2S. So that'll create an instance, but then the other problem we have is that I've got to queue up a call to one of the subs functions, which is done by this line here. This code needs to be rewritten. And now I can see where I've got my concurrency bug. It's actually all in here. So I've got one problem where if you've got an entity, there you go, you've got an entity. And it's got a whole lot of submethods on it. If you've got code calling different submethods, those submethods can't run concurrently. Now, that wouldn't be such a problem if you just have functions that like run through and terminate rather quickly after doing a couple of syscalls. The problem is that I've got some that act effectively like daemons or never terminating loops for things like listen loops and that sort of thing. So say, for example, you've got network code that listens and goes into an infinite loop and just accepts connections. Then no other function on that entity could be called. So I actually need to split, instead of having like a task which represents the running state of an entity, I need to have the entity state and then multiple tasks that map to that one entity state, so that they can all those separate calls can be substituted separately. And funnily enough, I actually wrote a document on this last night, the concurrency document, where I basically start outlining some of the concurrency guarantees this provides. But more importantly, I wanted to start modeling some of the APIs and what the code would actually look like. So, I mean, down here you can see the example of a listen loop and what happens when we do some locking and that sort of thing. And here, of course, these things on the end here actually allows you to denote the area where you've got exclusive access to the entity's state. Is that the best way to do it? The problem I have here is I've got a lot of terminology in the stack at the moment that has changed over time. And so I'm using conflicting terminology, but then some of the terminology is subtly different to, I guess you'd call state of the art or how it's used in other frameworks. And so there's a lot of confusion. Like I've actually got a task item to go through and just do nothing but rename everything and clean up the terminology. So let's get back to this network address. Okay, so I need an S2S instance, sender, destination tasks, fine, not self. Actually, this is confusing, right? So if we look up the destination where the entity lives in the hash table here, the distributed hash table here, and if it's not self, then we look it up locally, because find tasks looks up the local task, so that needs to be removed. We already know it's remote, so we can just do that, which means sender is network address, da 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 da. That returns an entity address. That is the entity address again, and then that's its state there. And then we add the state to the task to be run. We then shortcut all of this code, which is for routing locally and creating the task if it doesn't exist. So you can see that this code here actually mirrors this code here, which is another reason it needs a refactor, because a lot of this could be simplified. And then this does a scheduling of the actual sub or the method call. Okay. So let's see how badly I've done so far, because luckily I've got a fairly comprehensive test suite for this functionality. And that's definitely made this a lot quicker to test, because what we're actually testing at the moment is sending messages between two separate processes. And to set that up by hand, I have to go VVV, something like that. So we'll run that in the background. And of course it fails because I think I had a dash help on the end. Yeah. So I'd have to do something like that. Connection refused. That's interesting in itself. Cause that's bootstrap. Let's just listen first. So 3030, like that. And then I'd have to do the other one, which would be that one, and bootstraps off the 3030, but listens on 3031. Once again, got to remove the help. All right, see, this is just because there's a code error and I'm screwing around with things. But you get the idea. I'd have to run two processes, coordinate it, message it, and everything like that. Much, much easier just to have a test suite like this that I can call. It does sets everything up. And in fact, it actually runs both the sender and the receiver in the same process, but the communications still actually go over a TCP socket, which for testing purposes is absolutely wonderful. In an ideal world, it would not be a TCP socket on localhost. It would actually be a Unix domain socket or a pipe. Although it can't be a pipe because pipes don't support send and receive. They only support read and write. So I guess that's out. So it'd have to be a Unix domain socket. And the reason you want to use a Unix domain socket is rather than TCP is if you start using TCP in a test suite and you run it on a server and you run multiple versions of that concurrently, there's a good chance that any tests running at the same time might interfere with each other. Port clashes, which I mean, I've actually tried to avoid that with the RAN range, but you just don't know what's listening on localhost. With the Unix main socket, it's a lot easier to just write something with the file system, create a temporary directory, create the Unix socket in there, and you can pretty much be guaranteed that there's going to be nothing interfering with it, and it automatically cleans itself up afterwards. So there's that. And now I've lost my place. Which is, yeah. There we go. So how badly were we failing? S2S is not defined. Okay, that's fine. So how are we going to route that reference into there? So I think what we originally intended was you send a message to the routing table, and the routing table just kind of takes care of the magic object initialization and everything. For the moment, however, I think we're just going to cheat pretty badly. So we're up one directory, so we're going to have to go up one middleware dot. Now, this is actually interesting. This is a relative import, which not a lot of people know about in Python or use. Typically, what they'd actually do is that. The problem with doing that is sometimes there can be name clashes, and if you go to refactor your entire project and rename it, then you've got a lot of things to update. If you do a relative import like this, you can always be guaranteed that even if you install something called that clashes with the Epic Man name, the code will be relative to wherever this is actually defined. So it's basically designed to avoid name clashes. And then if you do like import utils, using the from is probably incorrect. If I had a module called OS and I did that, then what would happen is in 99% of the cases, you're going to get the Python OS module, not the your module called OS. So you actually have to do something like that, which means import the OS relative to this file. So I just make everything relative because it's helped me with refactoring so many times. Middleware dot mesh import S2S. As you can see, my typing or my spelling is not the best. So, as I said earlier, I could be working out what's going to happen before it happens, but I'm not really in the mood to do that today. I'd much rather just brute force this until I can get it working and then refine it. This is a very, very hard code to reason about, mainly because it's got three different styles of design in it, and I haven't quite worked out how all the pieces are supposed to fit together. Like, I've written code like this so many times, you think I'd be able to get it right by now, but each one is just slightly different, so... What are we failing on? No module found. Let me guess, didn't do a double dot. So actually, this is a good point to demonstrate the import thing. So you can see I've just done dot middleware, and then it's gone epicman.server.middleware. So if I do dot dot, it will actually remove that dot server component for me automatically, and that should work. And the reason I've laid it out like that way is in terms of the imports, is specifically because I used to have some really, really bad issues with circular imports. And then I started breaking things out to consts and util functions and everything like that. But I had one thing called syscalls, and the syscalls were used everywhere. And the syscalls actually made reference to objects, and like objects also made reference to syscall, and then that would cause massive import errors. So thanks for the follow, XLDO. Once again, I'm hoping that's how you pronounce it, but if you have any questions, just shout out. And honestly, it doesn't even have to be about programming or this. I like to talk about IT stuff in general, so I've had very many interesting jobs over the years, so a lot of people find it helpful to ask me things where I might have some insight. I've got a lot of insight into interviewing if you're currently looking for jobs. I've had to design multiple interview processes before, and it's something I enjoy doing a lot. So let's see what we're doing here. Attribute error. S2S has no make instance. That's all right, because we need an address. Oh, did that? Maybe that's not an entity address. Maybe that is returning me an instance. And in fact, I think that's a very, I've got a really, really bad design flaw in that I have a distinguish, well, I don't distinguish. Some things return entity addresses and some things just return the entity instance. And I think in nearly every case, I want the entity address, except in the main loop where I want the entity instances. So we're just going to cheat, I think. So that's defined, yes, so I can use it there. Bam, bam, bam. Network address is the instance of S2S. So this is one of those bad cases where everything is reversed. Network ADDR. Actually, let's check in with the type, my tests and everything. Okay. So, I mean, if you're seeing me program here, you probably notice one thing, and that's I'm doing everything from the terminal. I'm not running an IDE. I literally just use a text editor with like only highlighting, and that's about it. But I do have this little program here that I call iCheck, which is something I've written. But basically, it's iNotify based, and anytime one of these files updates, or actually more importantly, anytime I save a file, it kicks off a whole lot of syntax checks, type checks and everything in the background. And for some of those checks, they'll actually notify me. So if I do that, you'll see terminal 4 down here just lit up, and I actually hear a bell at my end. So what I tend to do is I will just actually do everything audibly. I'll just be doing it, and it means it doesn't take my focus away from the coding. If I do make a mistake, I get a notification. I quickly look back at the previous line and correct it. If I don't know what it is, I'll switch to the other terminal. So, bum, bum, bum. Test serialization. Entity proxy is not callable. Great. I really have no idea what I'm doing today. No, we need to be in the main loop. Okay. did it say literally say entity address is not entity proxy is not callable. Network address import network proxy. Oh yeah. Oh wow. I've got. I know what this is, network. So rather than creating an entity address from the entity, I can't because the entity is actually an entity proxy, and I have to then call, okay, I've got a lot, I've got a much better idea now of what I have to do in my refactor. It's not gonna block my 1.0 release, but it's gonna have to be one of the things, first things I address when I get this sorted. Entity proxy has no, I'm gonna call bullshit on that. Entity address, no, it's actually correct. I did rename that. Okay, a bit further. Entity proxy has no. Okay, this is annoying me enough. I'm gonna actually have to have a look at the object hierarchy. I think I've just got one level of interaction here that I shouldn't have, and that's what's causing me. And I don't mean just in this function call. I mean, in my entire design, I've got one level of indirection I probably shouldn't have that's causing confusion, so. Entity address. Where is my entity proxy? Entity proxy here, okay. So my entity proxy. Ah, okay. So this is a funny one. This is a really, really, really funny one. This is a order of precedence error. So I was assuming that network address is a tuple, and that was being matrix multiplied by S2S. So this is a matrix multiply operation that was introduced in Python 3.7. But to me, that looks like an email address, or, you know, like something they used for addressing in a chat network. And so I repurposed it for this. Under normal circumstances, this works fine, right? The problem is that and then I assumed like that would return an entity. Yeah, that would return an entity. And then you'd look up entity address on that proxy. It turns out that the method lookup here with the dot is higher precedence than that. So it's doing s2s.epicaddress, which is an entity proxy, because it hasn't had the entity instance added to it and been turned into an instance yet. So all we actually need to do here is just force the hand. Although what I actually tend to do is put this on two separate lines and do the, I guess, casting the entity proxy to an entity instance and then do the epic address lookup later. But did I save that? No, I didn't. So if my code is doing that, which is not returning, then it means I have got an infinite loop. Hey, 101 Oz. This is a, how do I put it? This is me writing a game server. But I make the distinction here between the infrastructure that runs a game and the actual logic that makes up a game. So all the game rules and everything. So this is just a server that will run a game eventually, and I've got to go off and run the game after this. But it's a bit special in that rather than there being one single server, there is a whole bunch of different processes that all connect to each other and form a mesh. And then all the game objects run on that mesh. So if all those servers are on different machines, it means your game is literally running over multiple machines simultaneously. And the idea is that I want to support one single large world without any sharding or anything. And so you can just keep on walking in one direction. And under the hood, you get transparently moved between server to server. But from the outside, there's no disconnection or reconnection or jumping from one region to the other. It's all just one seamless world, basically. And we're currently, everything's basically done apart from the sending messages between the servers. And that's what I'm working on. I'm doing a lot of low-level socket stuff, but honestly, using a high-level library like sockets.io if you're using JavaScript is actually not going to help you here, because the real difficulty here is in modeling the APIs to be easy to use and easy to understand, because the main loop started off simple when I started writing it a couple of weeks ago and has gotten very, very complex and needs a bit of a rewrite and refactor. But rather than doing that refactor, I'm just trying to get it working now, and then I'll fix it up later, because I don't really at this point have a good idea of what's going to be the cleanest way to refactor it or clean it up. So yeah, if you've got any questions or anything, just feel free to ask, as I said earlier, to other people. Doesn't necessarily have to be about this. It can be about programming in general or IT. I did used to work in IT. I'm just taking a bit of a break at the moment, but I do have a lot of knowledge in that area, so especially interviewing and that sort of thing. I'm assuming you're from Australia, so I'm over here in Sydney at the moment in the middle of lockdown, so it's a good time to do some programming. And actually, it was raining earlier, so it looks like it's cleared up a bit. So where was I? I'm very, very good at losing my point when I'm on stream. How I program on stream and how I program privately are slightly different. Although I still get quite badly distracted. I should get to have some water. So I've got an infinite loop. I'm pretty sure the infinite loop is on the listen somewhere. Yeah, just to basically distribute the stress or the load. If you've only got one server, then you're limited by the performance of a single core. In most cases. I mean, say, you could say, okay, go make your server multi-threaded, but at some point you have to do effectively merge everything together somewhere in your code, and that's going to be limited by the performance of a single core. I mean, there are some distributed algorithms. It starts to get very, very complex at that point, and it starts to look like operating system process scheduling. So I decided to just make the jump to it. Like, if you have a look at this code, right, and if I bring up the main loop here, you can see I literally call it main loop. And then we go down here. This code here is literally what starts and stops processes. So I'm using, this is all Python code. I'm actually using coroutines, and which are basically like generators or anything, and I'm actually starting and stopping them manually and injecting values into it. So dot throw injects an exception into the coroutine. The coroutine I'm just calling task here. So if there's no error from the last syscall, or if there's an error from the last syscall, I inject an exception. Otherwise, I pop a message off the message queue and then inject that into the process and wait for it to reply with which syscall it wants to run next. And then I've got some cleanup code down here in case the task exits. I mean, a task here is basically like a process under a standard operating system. And then once we go past that, we reset all the results. We do some type def stuff for reasons to make, well, just make the type system happy, because I'm using MyPy for some basic checking. I add, if there's a timeout on the syscall because everything is cancelable, I kick off the timeout, and then I handle each syscall separately. In truth, the only syscalls you really need here are task send and task receive, but there is some messy implementation details with sockets and blocking sockets, which means I actually do have to natively support like the standard socket stuff here in line. So basically I've got socket methods and task send and task receive. I don't have any syscalls for file open or read or write. And the reason for that is we use epoll or select under Linux. And that does, basically that will block until one of the file descriptors you pass it is ready to read or write. The only problem is under Linux and most operating systems is if you pass in a file to the select, it will always say it's readable. So there's actually no point in punting that out to the main loop. It's actually better to just block in line with the task. And so I assume that if you're doing file read and write, you just do it like you would with normal blocking code. And I'd have to go double check the async IO documents. I think, in fact, we can check that now. Go docs.python.org. I think async IO uses read or write. Library reference, yeah, that's it. Async IO. I think it provides some wrappers for read or write, but in actual truth, there's no reason to. You actually end up taking a pretty massive performance hit for no good reason when you're just going to be blocking the event loop anyway. Futures, transports, protocols, high-level API index, wait, sleep, gather, wait for. Actually, maybe not. Streams. Yeah, maybe not. Maybe they have worked that out. But that's basically it. No, what I'm saying is I don't manage state over files. So you just use read, write, or open or whatever in your async functions. And you, well, do I have an example? So if it was like this, you could, these awaits are actually operating on sockets. But if you were to do a file thing, rather than going like await, open, if, you know, f is equal to, oh man, it's actually getting very, very chilly here at the moment. So hands are not operating quite as well as I'd like. So rather than doing that, which is what you'd expect with asynchronous code, right? I'm saying there's actually no point in doing so, because under the hood it's always going to be blocking. You'd just be taking the overhead of the main loop for no reason. So you actually end up just doing the blocking calls, and then you literally just do the blocking reads and writes, because there's no way for me to do an asynchronous read or write currently, or at least with the standard selector stuff, so select or poll or epoll. There is actually a way to do it with IOU ring, and one of the next things I'll be doing is actually switching over to IOU ring. And IOU ring is not necessarily a asynchronous framework for doing file IO. It's actually a way to do asynchronous syscalls. So it means that in the future, you'll be able to perform any syscall under Linux asynchronously and just read from a queue. So you can like batch up 10 or 20 different syscalls simultaneously and then read them all out of order as they complete. and I know if I do it that way, then I can actually do an asynchronous read or write. So this is probably a good time to actually point out the differences between IO under Windows and Linux. So Windows very much has a completion-based IO, which means that you submit everything you want done, and then when it's done, it says, hey, look, I'm done, here's the result. And that's actually a really, really awesome API to work with. The only thing I disagree with is that result comes back in a thread, and that thread gets created for you. And I don't really like that loss of control. This code goes to great lengths to control the threading model. And so if I've got threads coming up, that means I've got to suddenly start doing locking and dealing with concurrency. Whereas I've tried to make this single threaded for a whole lot of reasons, but mainly to guarantee exclusive access to specific state and memory. So you don't actually have to worry about, you as a user writing a game, you don't have to worry about locking too much. You can just write your code as normal looking code, and magically it might be running across the network, but that's all hidden from you. So it looks like you're running single threaded code, but under the hood we're cheating. We're actually multi-threading it where we can, where you won't notice it basically. Unix has a different way of going about it. It has what's known as a readiness-based API, which means epoll, for example, tells you this socket is ready to be written to. It doesn't tell you how many bytes that you can write to, so you actually have to make an attempt to write as much as you can, and then the write will tell you how many bytes it did write, and then you have to update your buffers, and then come back and try again. You poll again for when it is ready to take more writes. So it ends up being a bit more work. The async or the IOU ring stuff that hit Linux 5.0 adds a completion-based IO system. But not only does it add a completion-based IO system, as I said, it's syscall-based, but it also adds a concept of chaining. So now rather than saying, hey, tell me when this read is done, you can actually say, tell me when this chain of actions is done. So I can actually go to the IOU ring and go, hey, open this file, seek to this position, read these bytes, write these bytes, then read these bytes, and then tell me when all those operations are done in one. I don't want to say atomic unit, because it's not atomic, but you don't get notified for every single individual step. You can just do it all in one go. Now, I actually really, really like this because I tend to like open a file then read it, and I don't like issuing two syscalls. The open and the reads can get expensive. I mean, it's probably dwarfed by Python code, but I'm C compiling some of this code, and I'm also jitting some of this code, which speeds it up quite dramatically. So I do notice that. Yeah, the IOU, you know, that's probably a good way of putting it. I like that a lot. So, I mean, in Golang, that's not threads, right? That's green threading. Now, this is where it gets really funny and mind-blowing, so just one sec. What I've effectively done is implemented the Golang runtime in Python. Now, this may seem stupid, but there's actually precedence for it. Python has had the Golang-like green threading since way before Go was an actual thing. There was an actual build of Python called Stackless Python that implemented an API very, very similar to Golang with its channel support and everything, like a good 10, 15 years ago. And when I first started trying to write this game, which was literally 10, 15 years ago, I actually did start with that. So I'm actually somewhat familiar with Golang's concurrency model and its channel stuff and how you do that day to day, if I'm not necessarily familiar with Go itself. But one of the other things I did experiment around with was Erlang and its actor-based concurrency, which once again, very, very similar to Go. I don't know. No, it does have the concept of channels as well, but it's all functional programming. So yeah, I mean, the only real difference between green threads and operating system threads and green threads is a threading done by the operating system, or is a state managed by the operating system, or is the state managed by the application? Apart from that, there's no real difference between it. So an OS thread, for example, has a PID. A green thread will not have a PID that's visible outside the process. It may have some sort of identifier inside the process, but that's about it. Green threads, you'll probably see references to coroutines, and you probably would have heard me talk about coroutines earlier. A coroutine is basically a function that can return values more than once, which is kind of crazy. And they're probably the more powerful concept because they're not just limited to, they're a way to implement green threads, but they're not limited to just green threading. The channel stuff is actually a separate concept. I'm implementing buffered channels at the moment. I'm not 100% okay with buffered channels in this design implementation. I kind of want there to be a one-to-one correspondence. Like, I don't want to queue up messages. The fact that I've actually got a queue here is actually more of an implementation detail. I actually want to spin up a green thread for every item in the channel if you were coming from Go, and then run them all concurrently. And that's where I've made a mistake with my current design. So it's working at the moment, but I've got a very, very terrible bug, right? Because I queue everything up, and because I route all the method calls via one single method. So I've actually got a dispatch thing that dispatches to other methods rather than invoking them directly. If I've got two pieces of code calling different methods on the same entity, then they actually block. And then I run into this really weird issue where if I've got like a dot listen, which goes into an infinite loop because it's just listening and accepting connections, then the other method never gets called, which is why I don't want to have this buffered queue at all, because that would always end up in the same bad spot. Unless I get rid of the dispatch thread, which technically I could do. Actually, now that brings up an interesting point, because I've now got the network involved, and I don't if everything's running locally, I don't necessarily need to have everything buffered, right? Because, or do I? I was going to say, I don't need to worry about that because there's always a sender that I can match to a receiver, and the sender is always going to be blocked. But I guess the same really applies on the network case as well. I still haven't worked, like, it's very, very much possible that this code could DOS. Like, you could write code that would DOS itself, so. Well, I'm trying to ensure that I don't lose any messages, although I have to take care of this into account because processes can go away at any time. There's certain parts of this code I'm definitely trying not to think about at the moment. So if you're asking me questions I don't necessarily want to think about, but I'm going to have to think about at some point. So I've got a rough idea of the failure models I want to implement and deal with, but I don't necessarily want to think about and start accommodating that code right this minute. So like the fact I'm using a distributed hash table with gossip, it means I do have to consider nodes coming and going and what happens if they're actually currently executing code. Because say I have a node become unreachable for 5 to 10 seconds, and the code it executes is completes and it saves state to disk. But the other nodes detect that that node screwed up. And then so they reroute the messages to another one, and then another instance of that entity runs concurrently and saves its state to a different machine. When that cluster resumes communication, how do I rectify the two different states? I've effectively split brained at the moment at that point, and then how do I rejoin that? And that's a hard question. That's at the moment, I'm just pretending everything's 100% stable and nothing will ever fail. But once I go to the network model, packets are going to get lost, reordered, machines are going to come and go from the network, and I'll have to worry about that. And there's a couple of ways to do that. I can persist the state to a central database, and I've got support for that. Because the other thing that this does is when an entity exits, it persists its state to the database automatically. I'm using virtual actors. So in Golang, you're probably creating the Go threads explicitly. In my case, you just send the Go thread a message, and then under the hood, it magically comes into existence like it never actually terminated. It's like these Go threads always existed, and when they do exit, they persist their state to a database and then shut down. So I actually garbage collect them in the background, and if I start to run out of memory, I can just start garbage collecting a hold of these threads preemptively, knowing that I can restore their state from the database at any time and resume them where they left off. I could use a central DB, and I'm very, very tempted to. It's really going to come down to how quickly everything's exiting, because I think in the normal case that will work, but in the worst case, it will actually be, the performance will be catastrophic. So say you've got a whole lot of clients connecting, if stuff starts crashing and that's when you need things to be quick, the performance is going to be absolutely abysmal, because everything's going to be writing to the database directly. I was actually wondering if I might have a multi-layered database cache such that I write locally and then push to the central database as well. But what I want to try and get to is a point where I write the state locally and then to two or three other nodes, so that if your current node goes down, all the other nodes can calculate the where the data might be stored in other nodes. Luckily, if you don't have entities exiting all the time, the write rate shouldn't be too bad. But this is one of these things I'm not going to really know until I start writing the game itself. Oh, no, yeah, like, honestly, it's already at the blockchain level. I'm using distributed hash tables, so I'm not using a blockchain. I'm actually using BitTorrent technology. It's very, very similar, but subtly different. I've basically got a hash table, and each node registers itself multiple times on the table. And then I'm looking that up. I'm looking up the address of the entities on that table. And if the address points to yourself, then you know that entity is actually running locally and you don't need to route it over the network. Otherwise, that routing table returns the address of the remote node that needs to be messaged. And then I've got a gossip protocol. So when a node comes up, it bootstraps off another machine, and it will contact all its neighbors, its closest neighbors, and a couple of other nodes around the ring, and register themselves with it. And any node that receives a message that's not addressed to itself will forward that message onto the next node that it knows is closest to the destination. And if you do that and play with some of the math, then you get a relatively efficient network implementation. It's not perfect because everything's not direct routed, but if I fiddle around with the math, I can ensure that for a given cluster size, the network packet doesn't transverse more than three nodes, for example. No, you can't. Well, you could use a blockchain, but it'd be totally and utterly stupid, because the blockchain is a Merkle tree with a proof of work, and there's no reason whatsoever to have a proof of work in this. Like, everything's trusted. The proof of work is where you have hostile nodes to each other. And I don't, so there's no reason to take the overhead of blockchain tech anyway. If I was, I'd probably use a central source of truth with a a hashed ledger, which is the one of the core. Well, so a blockchain is basically some very, very old technology with a proof of work added on top of it. And I just use that old technology, which is just a distributed hash table. Well, not it's a chained. So I can't actually remember what the name of it is. It's not a Merkle tree. It's basically you sign every entry is the current entry plus all the entries previously hashed. It's a chained ledger or something like that. And they added the proof of work just to get around the central authority thing. So, but basically, this technology, like this is how BitTorrent works, right? You don't necessarily have a direct connection to, you've got a hash table, which is the DHT, but you don't necessarily have a direct connection to the final destination node that's holding the data. So you actually hop your packet around the network or around the ring. And that's essentially what I'm doing here. Or trying to anyway. Need more water. I've forgotten how quickly this dries me out. So I've got an infinite loop, and this is what I need to work out. Keyboard interrupt, where am I dying though? I do need, I'm just gonna add some options here. There we go. Now that does give me the stack trace, and I'm pretty sure if we have a look up here, so we're actually still in the setup code, and I really hope that's not the listen. The other problem that makes this code particularly difficult is because it's asynchronous, and the work that's being done and the tasks that invoke that work are not directly related, because the work that's being done is being executed in a separate context or a separate stack to the thing that actually issued it. It can make tracing who issued the current piece of work very, very difficult. And I don't think I've really provided enough information in my thread to be able to debug this. I definitely need to work on some debug tools and even an interactive prompt just to be able to work out, hey, what's the current syscall executing? Who issued that? And then being able to get a stack trace from that blocked process itself. And I've avoided doing that because there's some pretty gnarly performance hit. And I'm using PyPy with its JIT. And some of the introspection features that are required to do that will actually turn the JIT off. And that JIT is actually pretty important for performance. That's not to say I can't do it. I just can't do it in the main loop. If I've got another thread that you connect to, and then that introspects the state of the main running process, that'll work fine. But once again, that's stuff I didn't really want to implement. I've avoided multi-threading the main loop at this point. But when I go to the IOU ring, I might actually have to add threads, and I might take that opportunity to also add the thread for the introspection tools. I will never be multi-threading the main loop, because I'm relying on multi-process for concurrency rather than multi-threading. But that doesn't mean I can't have some background workers doing specific things. And that's mainly just to reduce latency. I could thread that into the main loop, but it's actually slightly lower latency to let the Python interpreter handle the task switching rather than waiting until you return to the main loop. So, in fact, I can show you now. The actual IO stuff is pretty simple. So we check if there's any other threads to be running to run, or if there's anything to be cancelled. If not, we just block here. We load up the selector with all the things to like listen to, and then we block here until there is IO, or if there are actually threads to be run still, this is a non-blocking operation. It would just grab everything that's available and then move on. And then we just process them, which is, we actually implement a, we pass callbacks through. So you can see I pull out the data from the event, which is the call, the arguments to that call, and the task that issued the call. And then I literally just do the call back with the arguments it provided, get the return value, and then I update the Siskel resolve the task there. And then on the next one, we go back to the top and that gets re-injected back into the task here. So really stupidly simple. And that used to be the entirety of the, until I started adding syscalls beyond task send and receive, that like that code was like, I don't know, 30, 40 lines. Okay, so let's go back here. We need to have a look at that stack trace. And PyTest scheduler main loop, that's good. Selector.poll. So I need to have a look at timeout first, because we need to work out what sort of timeout we're doing. So we're doing a 1 second timeout, which is unusual because I can't actually remember where I do a 1 second timeout. So I've got my timeouts at the top. I've got block and we've got no wait. Okay, so if we're doing a block, that means there's no other tasks to be executed, but we're doing IO. So no other tasks are running or need to be run, but we've still got pending IO. Okay, that's good. So can we pull? Build a backend service with an API, which manages state and database calls, which is called from my game server. Yeah, I could do that. Was there any reason why you split that up? Was it because there was a whole lot of blocking calls or something like that? It seems unusual to add that indirection. I'm not familiar with 5M. Is it a library or? Like, I'm familiar with the concepts of Go, but I don't actually program. I haven't programmed with Go day to day, so feel free to enlighten me. It's one of those things, I both love Go, but knowing some of the history, I'm just really hesitant to use Go. Ah, GTA modding framework. Oh, that'd be interesting. Yeah, one of the things I realized, like, so I've been researching game development for years and years and years. Like, the engines seem very, very primitive. And the designs seem very, very primitive from a web perspective. Like, the fact that they can't scale out. And some of the ways they're written are just always have me scratching my head. So part of this is to sort of introduce a lot of the web technology and the scalability and failure model technology to game worlds. I mean, I've come from a systems administration and SRE background. And so I wanted to try and bring some of those lessons with me to the game engine. Ah, okay, yeah. I thought that might be the case with the offloading. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I don't know if I necessarily like using HTTP. I did some tracing and benchmarking of just how expensive HTTP was. And it's kind of scary. So I'm actually... My main loop, when it's jittered on an i7, on a single core, will do about 2 million messages per second. On an Apple M1, it'll actually do 2.5 million messages per second. Like, those M1 Apple chips are just stupidly powerful. And this is not a slow i7 chip by any means. I've forgotten where I was going with it. I wanted to use gRPC, yeah. I'm going a bit lower than gRPC. I didn't use gRPC because gRPC brings in its own IO model. And I'm very much a fan of Sans IO, where your libraries focus on serialization and it's up to you to do the scheduling of the IO. And that actually became very, very important in this library, because it means if I want to go off and test something, do I have, actually that was the wrong one. If I want to go off and test something, what is a good example? Logging, routing, no test entity. I've just got to feed it. No, that's not it. Basically, I can feed the entity a list of like pre-processed items that look like IO but are actually not. Whereas if the if my entities had like direct IO calls embedded in them, then I'd have to go off and mock them out. The fact it goes through a syscall layer means I can fake the entire syscalls with just dummy data that I read off a list. Effectively, these are all state machines. It doesn't look like it, but everywhere I've got an await, that's a transition in a state machine, which makes testing really, really, really simple. And I've seen a lot of people do it. Like, I've been watching a lot of game development on Twitch, and not a lot of people are testing their code, or there doesn't really seem to be people with massive test frameworks. And I think, actually, let's run a quick test, because I haven't done it in a while. I've got a full, my test suite is actually part of my coverage suite as well, so. And that's going to fail in my infinite loop, isn't it? Yes, it is. So we have to fix that first. I can actually fix this quite simply by just dropping the T, because we do auto-discovery. Ah, FinTech. So that's interesting. I actually used to work for Optiva, which high-frequency trading company. And the only reason I quit was I'm a double lung transplant recipient, and I actually had started to have rejection, and it made it very, very difficult to work. So I'm very, very familiar with high performance networking and that sort of thing. Even before I started working in finance, which it was interesting moving from web tech to fintech. I thought I would learn a lot, but it turns out that my study in my own time had already sort of taught me a lot of the lessons for high performance code already. That didn't give me a coverage report on the command line. Leaving directory. I mean, I could just bring up the website, which is docs.epicman.com, and there's actually a coverage page there. I actually push out all financial crime prevention. Now that would be really, really interesting. I had a fun story about this. Like, I was actually going for a role at British Telecom as a security engineer. And they said, oh, why don't you go and do an interview at that finance company? And I thought, I've got the time. I'm waiting for a reply back from BT or whatever. Like, why not? And the fintech company came back and said, hey, yeah, we'd like to have you. And I said, like, no, I want to wait for the security role. And I just kept on getting strung along by British Telecom. It wasn't Sydney office's fault at all. It was just an unfortunate situation. So I ended up in fintech, although I wanted to do computer security, because it's just something I've done a lot of over the years. It's never been a formal role, but whenever a security issue came up, it was always handed to me. So I can only imagine what your systems look like. You're never too young for security type work. Although maybe in the fintech space, that's probably a bit different, but on the web space, you normally try and fork it off to as far down the chain as possible, because it's just such boring work. So I've got the infinite loop. Actually, you know what? I'm going to pull up the coverage stuff. So I'm just making sure I've got nothing compromising in my browser at the moment. Well, I actually had a Twitch stream a couple of moments ago, so I just don't want to be streaming someone else's stuff at the moment. So if we go here, I think I've got it under here. Oh, I've got to be careful I don't bump my laptop. There we go. Concurrency, examples, coverage report. Here we go. So I've got about 74% coverage. And I'm not aiming for 100% coverage. I know the areas that need to be tested more than others. And I'm going off and adding testing when it's appropriate, because testing and therefore locking in the interface before I'm done finishing up what the interface looks like is a very, very good way to make my code a bit brittle. And what I tend to do is I'll do a lot of manual testing until I work out what type of testing needs to be done. So I know there's a lot of people who disagree with me, especially a lot of people out of university who disagree with me. But the fact that my code still works, and the fact that I only started type checking last week after I'd written 2,000 lines of code, and I only had 3 type errors in the entire code base, should kind of give you an indication of maybe being, maybe it's not strictly required if you know what you're doing. No, that's actually a very, very bad excuse. I think I got lucky, if anything else. So let's get back to that and drop down to that. Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I don't do C or anything because it's just, you spend so much time just doing unnecessary stuff like memory management. But I know how to make Python quick enough. Like, as I said, this main loop, probably not anymore, but when I originally wrote it, did 2 million messages per second on an i7. If I was running out of I.O., I just had another machine. I know how to compile Python code down to C, which surprises people. It is actually possible. There's about 6 different ways to do it, depending on how your code's written. But I'm just using PyPy JIT, which is more than fast enough. But do I actually have any at the moment? If I go... So I was working on this project when I was working in... doing the finance stuff, because we're having a problem with passing XML files. It's test, isn't it? Yeah, so, I mean, I do write C code. In fact, I'm actually not writing C code. What I'm actually doing is writing assembler. So, sumd.c. Yeah. Bum, bum, bum. Like up here. We're doing XML. I was doing SIMD XML matching. So, if we do benchmark SIMD larger file, let's warm up a bit. This machine's a bit slow because I'm actually not developing on an Intel processor here. I'm actually developing on a mobile phone class CPU, so an ARM processor. And this file is, yeah, like 500, nearly 600 megs. So ignore this because I had to truncate some of the files for some of the tests, but like passing XML at 4.5 gigabytes per second. The naive implementation's only that. But this is also a completely new way of passing XML, where I actually use database techniques to build a in-memory data structure such that searching is super, super quick. So, oh yeah, like, you know what? That was the one thing that scared me about working in finance, right? Was the passes and the specifications are just insane. And then like never updated. They're extended, but never updated. Yeah, like some of the exchange stuff is kind of crazy as well. And actually, I started in the compliance team as well, and some of the stuff we got from third parties, I had some of the file formats we had to provide, were just did my head in. So checkpoints, test serial. I'm going to run the test suite again because, as I said, I'm going to lose my position really, really quickly otherwise. Ah, commented out the test, that's right. So yeah, back to languages. I know a bit of C, enough to build large programs, but honestly, I wouldn't build large programs in C, I just wouldn't be confident. I played around with Rust, and I still continue to do so because the Rust and Python integration is getting a lot better. And I'm liking that a bit. I'm not totally tied to it. Go had some warning flags, which are more in my head than being actual problems. It's opinionated in ways I don't necessarily like things to be opinionated, but given the author, that I can't kind of understand that. But I do assemble, and anytime I need speed, I either inline C code in my Python code or I inline assembler in my Python code. It's not, never really been too much of an issue for me. And I mean, this is probably the highest performance thing I've had to write. Well, I did write a load balancer in Python, and that topped out at about 22 gigabit per second. And let me tell you, it's hard to find a network with 22 gigabits per second to actually test that in the first place. So, but the trick there was not to do it in Python, but to use the splice syscall so that Python was only invoked after for the first packet. And once you'd made the routing decision, the kernel handled the rest of the transition. So the actual load balancer was like 100 lines and would push 22 gigabit with no problem. And the problem was that Python was so slow on that initial packet that's why it wasn't topping out at the 40 gigabits that the network maxed out at. But there's no reason why I couldn't do the setup and the config parsing in Python and then do the initial packet stuff in C. I just decided not to push the code any further. So 22 gigabits was fast enough, basically. But you do have to be very, very careful when you're trying to make Python very, very fast. So it's definitely not the ideal way to approach it. It just allows me to iterate and be very, very quick. Like, I'm pretty sure I will end up rewriting a lot of this code in line C, if not outright C, when I'm happy with it. And once I've really locked in the design. Yeah, that's a good point. Like, there's actually only a couple of rules you have to follow in Python. And probably the biggest one is stop using third-party libraries. Because I've actually... It's amazing how like many nested function calls there are in those third-party libraries. And I try and keep... Like, function calls in Python are expensive. Like, people don't realize that. They're hideously expensive. They're one of the most expensive things you can do. So you really want... long, large functions compared to making a whole lot of small function calls. And that's really probably the biggest win is if it's simple, just don't use a third-party library. Like, and keep your code simple. That's it. Like, it's amazing. So, as I said, I used to do a lot of interviewing at all my roles, but the last one in particular, finance companies have this absolute love of interns and university students. And we didn't quite have a live coding stuff, but we did have one or two things that did require a bit of coding. And it was just amazing. Is inefficient the right word? I guess roundabout some of the solutions are to some of the problems. Like, you know, we didn't have a program question, we had like a design question. And it's like, we have a central logging server, all these machines have log files in a directory on the server, they're updated constantly by the applications. We need all the log files on the central server by the end of the day. Like, how do you implement that? And we used to get some of the weirdest answers to it. Like, I want to say 70% of the candidates would say, oh, we get all the applications to log their log lines to a database. And it was like, at that point, I might as well just tell the candidate to leave the room. It's not that they were wrong. It was just a really, really bad solution to the problem. But the problem was that I knew, because I'd tried it a couple of times, if they'd answered that, even if I handed them the correct answer, to get them back on track to using the correct answer was going to take more time than we had left in the interview. I guess that's slightly off topic, but when they got to the next stage where we actually got them in the office, most of our time was spent was, okay, go write X. And they go write X. And then we'd have to sit down with them and say, Like, why did you do that? Like, why didn't you use a simple library? Like, why did you import 10 different libraries just to download a file? Couldn't you have just used this inbuilt function? That sort of stuff. It was always kind of mind-blowing. If you do threading on library, use concurrence.futures. It makes things a lot simpler. Yeah, you know what? I'm really, really glad to hear that, because I kept on saying, and no one in management likes to hear this, like 1 or 2 years worth of actual work experience is worth 4 years of a university degree. So, like, it turned out that I kept tabs on it. Turns out most of the people we were hiring were the people that had done an internship with an actual company for like 6 months or more, or two internships. It's like there was such a clear leap in their ability to solve problems and actually produce code that we weren't going to throw away after the internship. It was incredible. And the people that got offers, like if you actually had work experience, your chances of getting an offer after your internship like tripled. It was insane. It's like the computer science teaches you to solve the wrong problems you're not going to solve day to day. It teaches you how to solve computer science problems, but computer science problems are not your day to day. Like I'm not going to ask you to implement a linked list, right, on a day to day basis. Like no one's going to ask you to do that. There's libraries to do that. That's a waste of time for a company to ask you to implement that. But it's like, oh, how do I comply with three different regulatory environments and where do I store the data? Like you ask that to a university student and they just blank. But like, that's what they're going to be doing day one. So yeah, see, I like that. It's interesting. I studied electrical engineering. Didn't actually ever formally finish the degree because there was an issue with the exemptions. So I did all the modules, but wasn't credited with what I needed to actually finish. But this was just a TAFE. Apart from that, I was self-taught, but I was doing programming long before that as well. Yeah, I like the startup stuff. I did some stuff that wasn't quite startup, but just post-startup. And I do like the agility. I don't like the bureaucracy of the larger organizations. It really, really wears on me. Yeah, 4 to 20 people is a good one. Where you can get the entire office into a restaurant is basically the perfect number. And I actually dodged a bullet. I actually interviewed for Google at one point. That was actually just before I got my lung transplant. And the lung transplant prevented me from starting at Google. And I'm really, really glad I didn't go down that route now. So I'll wait for you to type that. And while that's happening, I'm going to break my code. So did I rename it? I did. Save that. That'll put me there. So I need to do self dot. No, I need to be up one level. Running task dot set default task. Actually, I'll just be back in 1 sec. I have to go to the bathroom. Well, wrong scene. As you can see, it's getting dark here at the moment. Actually, I find that interesting with a startup, because hiring is always such an issue for startups. Normally, I would have expected that the junior would just be given more responsibility, more than they're capable of. But it sounds like you might possibly be worried about your position. Yeah. Yeah, IT is weird. I always felt that the higher I went up the chain, like the less work I had to do, which I don't like because I like to keep myself busy. So I ended up taking on too much work, no matter how senior I was. In fact, it's really, really weird being known as a senior administrator or SRE. It doesn't feel like it at all. System instance 0. So we're actually even not running yet. So I actually terminated too early. Which is really, really weird. Well, I suppose from an investor point of view, that makes sense. But I've had less of an... See, that's actually very, very different, right? I actually wonder if that's a fintech-specific thing. On the web tech, you would have seen them load up on people around your age very, very early. If not, the entire company would have been people around your age. But I did find fintech was... I wouldn't say we're different in that respect. And that's kind of why... So there's certain aspects about IT I really, really hate. and one of it is just how much of it is being driven by people fresh out of uni who haven't learned the lessons that... Like I spent the last 15, 20 years about managing servers I've learned, and then just reinventing the entire thing from scratch. So I've got a pretty bad hatred of Docker. And it's not containers, it's just Docker. and it comes down to the fact that Docker made so many obvious mistakes up front that were easily avoidable, that would just look like bad hacks. And they still haven't done anything to fix those up to this day. And that really irritates me that it's now become one of the major winners of the container wars. Although it looks like it's being very steadily supplanted. I should just link you to the talks about it. Like, I actually did 3 talks at linux.conf today on containers. The networking model sucks. If you understand the history of Docker, it makes sense. They're originally trying to build a platform as a service, as a startup, and really, really badly failed. And so when you control everything and you're building a platform as a service and you're telling people to build to your spec, that's totally fine. But it meant that you had to accommodate you had to write your programs to accommodate Docker rather than Docker just accommodating programs. And given that they were in control of the firewall and could do port forwarding, there's no reason to tell an application what port to start up on. You could quite just tell Docker to remap that port, the internal port to the external port. And they do have that ability now, and you see a lot of people using it in their recipes. But it seems kind of stupid that originally they were telling... Like, you couldn't do that firewall remapping. You actually had to specifically pass in which port you listened to, which was great. But at the time Docker was introduced, a whole lot of Java programs did not allow you to remap the ports. So Java and Docker was a bit of a hit and miss situation. so that was a big one. And then there was the entire let's not do stateful containers stuff. And like every single conversation I had with people was like, but I need to put a database somewhere, or I need to do some state. And like, there's some very, very obvious solutions to that. But for years, people were trying to say like, don't do stateful containers. And that generally that's good advice, but there's just a few specific situations where you do need it, and people have to implement bad solutions to basically be able to do that. So I complain a lot less about it these days than I used to. And like the CLI is an absolute complete and utter mess. That could have been so much better and so much simpler, but no. And then I guess my last complaint would just be the Docker recipe files themselves are not well thought out. So, like, the reason I did my talks was, like, containers are not a hard concept. Like, you can write a container implementation in a weekend. There's nothing magic or special about them. They're just processes and groups of processes. But they very, very quickly got treated as this mystical thing that you should never really attempt to do yourself. And I agree, in production, you shouldn't try and attempt to do it yourself, but they're not difficult to understand, and you should have an understanding of how they work. So, where are we at? We're on self.selector. We need to go up one level in the stack trace. And we need to have a look at the selector. Dot, can I tab complete that? No. So I'm actually not making a lot of progress, but, like, honestly, I prefer to talk to people. So this has been a fun conversation. Git map. And I tend to find that these, like, especially when I'm working on complex code like this, I don't have to make necessarily a lot of progress on stream. It just lubricates my mind enough to think about the problem, and then what'll happen probably tonight is it'll all click and I'll just write in half an hour. So, select, don't tell me it's an iterable. Why can't I get selector.select mapping? You know why? Maybe some API, like, I love Python. It definitely has its issues, but the more the version increase number increases and the more they sort of cave to people in Python ideas to add X random language feature, the more it's really become a shitty thing to work in. I shouldn't really complain about that, but, like, the computer scientist people are requesting features left and right that are difficult to implement and I don't think really make a lot of sense, just to save, like, three characters. And, like, they'll even justify it. It's like, I'm going to save three characters. It's like, if you look at other people programming on stream, the thing that's slowing them down is actually not typing, it's thinking through the problem. Like, stop doing these micro-optimizations for things that are not on the critical path. That's set. Error and argument. Let me think this through. Select.getMapList.blam. Set it? Yeah, that's okay. List is a reserved command in the debugger. Yeah, I like Python classes for what people now use data classes for. For me, classes don't necessarily hold behavior, they hold value. I try and treat classes as structures. Being self-taught, I tried to learn object-oriented stuff and very, very quickly realized that it's not applicable to the real world. And then just try to make classes useful. Sometimes it's handy to take carry methods along with it, but generally, I don't want to say I like functional programming. I like all the ideas of functional programming. I don't like being restricted to functional programming, however. And that's where I think pure functional programming languages, I don't want to say they're doomed to fail. I think they're just a bit of a dead end. Unless you've got a way to do other language paradigms. Because at the end of the day, it's not about being pure mathematical or whatever, it's about expressing a solution to the problem. And if you've got only one way to express that, in some ways you're tying your hand behind your back. So we have three sockets. 127.7702. And 7702. One's on accept. And one is connecting to that. Okay, so we know where we are in our code. We have gone from there to there to there. I much prefer backend. Some of the stuff in HTML and JavaScript is just, it really has come down to that, like, JavaScript, some of the practice in JavaScript are the epitome of what I consider some of the worst anti-patterns, which is like include use a third-party library for everything, no matter how trivial the actual functionality is. And like I was watching someone use Socket.io and I said, oh, like, why don't you just use Socket send receive and whatnot? Because I think they were using Node.js. And like I understood like they were using WebSockets, but like they didn't know socket programming, and socket programming was this like mystical thing. That's like it's just connect or open create a socket object, connect, send and receive. And there's a lot of people trying to do like people avoid creating protocols because packetization and serialization like scare people. Whereas if you have a look at my code, we need to be on mesh. I've gone, like these are not the final implementations, these are just dummy implementations, but this is a serialization packetization. Like packetization, I get the length of the data, I append 2 bytes to the beginning of it, and I just read those 2 bytes and then like read those 2 bytes, interpret them, and then read whatever they point to, and then pass it to the depacketize. And then I'm just using Pickle for the serialization, deserialization. This is, if I'm going to swap out gRPC, this is where I'm going to use gRPC, this is where I'm going to do it. And that's literally why I wrote these classes, is to make it very, very easy to swap them in and out later. In fact, I'm going to have multiple serialization methods. Pickle serialization is actually useful mainly for testing and in a very, very few specific concepts. And it meant I could just work on the actual problem I'm trying to solve, which is sending packets across a wire rather than what is the ultimate serialization, deserialization method. Because one issue I've got is I can have multiple versions of the same code running on my cluster if you're halfway through a migration. And so it's not necessarily enough to be able to have gRPC if the gRPC definition has sort of changed. I don't know how to deal with that at this point in time. So say you've got a newer process sending to an older process, like what's that going to do? Pickle sort of solves that, as long as you stick with a few rules. And what I'm finding is as I'm solving it on the Pickle land, then I'll know what the criteria I need for any other serialization library is going to be, or the problems I'm going to hit. And then I can take those lessons learned and write my own wrappers for the serialization, be it gRPC or Arvo or whatever it ends up being. Why did that chat sort of... Yeah, I'm a big fan of raw HTML, CSS and JS. So here's one really, really nice trick for really, really performant websites. make your website smaller than 15 kilobytes. And then on high latency links, it appears almost instant. Now, it's a bit counterintuitive. In fact, you probably want to make it smaller than that. You probably want to make it 10K. The reason it being is the initial congestion window of TCP on most operating systems is 10 packets. And if your MTU is 1,500 bytes, it works out to be 15K. But you've got to add headers and everything. So the initial congestion window means like, how many packets can I send before I have to wait for an acknowledgement from the other end, before I can send more data. So if your data goes over the initial congestion window, you actually have to take 2 round trips to be able to send all your data. So if you've got a website in like the US, which I've got some stuff in the US, and I'm in Australia and that's a 200 millisecond link, that means the page is not gonna render for 400 milliseconds. Whereas if you keep it under the 15 kilobytes for the entire request body, then hey, that's 200 milliseconds. And that's a really massive saving. I was watching Retro MMO stream and I've been playing his game and all his assets are hosted in S3. And S3 has a couple of peculiarities when it comes to international links. The network buffer sizes are too small for international high-speed transfer. So for S3 from Amazon in the US, I only get like 1 megabit. Even though I'm on a 100 megabit link here at home, which is just really, really annoying. So the game takes 60 seconds to load up every single time, transfers really, really, really poorly, ramps up over time. But like the first couple of requests are latency bound. And then it takes a while for, once it does start the transfer of a large bunch of files, it takes a while to ramp up. And I've talked to him about it. He doesn't really want to solve it. And I can't blame him because he doesn't really have a team and he's done pretty wonderful things for what he has done. But I kind of wish he had assets hosted around the world. Like, I don't know if there's like a geo-distributed S3 option. I can't remember. It's been too long since I played with S3. It's one of the things I like about fintech is I haven't had to deal with... Oh, sorry. One of the reasons why I liked HFTs is because going out to Amazon was too expensive because all our stuff is co-located at the exchange. And so I got to avoid cloud for just a little bit longer because there's so much insanity in cloud as well. Yeah, it's pretty crazy. It's really, 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 really crazy. And, you know, part of it seems to be that these people are not coming up with a fundamental design beforehand. They're just hacking away at it and then building something that works and then adding caching. And the problem with that is it's really hard to reason about. If you think the problem through and you have a really, really strong caching model up front, it's so much easier and so much more performant, or at least in my opinion. But unfortunately, it's one of those things that takes skill and a bit of practice to accumulate. So I'm definitely guilty of screwing up in that regard. And making absolute monstrosities. So those are blocking. I'm just realizing there should be a third connection here. So let's have a look. We've got 7 data. Bound method accept. So the accept should create another socket for the receiver. So I actually wonder if I've hit that concurrency bug, because I'm pretty sure the accepting thing and the thing that actually processes the new connection are the same instance ID or instance address. Where am I going to find that? I need to be in the debug shell, which I am, and I should be, there should be 3 tasks here. There's only 1 task. That's concerning. Do task. What do I have on there? Task dot namespace. Set an S to S. Test serialization sender. Okay. Oh, I know what's... Do I know what's happened? Listen. Then where is the second socket connection coming from? Ah, unless that's... Okay, so here's one scenario, right? We've listened. We've then done an outgoing connection. That outgoing connection has started up, sent all its data, and then shut down. The listen has then spawned off a child socket. That child socket has been queued up to run but never actually executed. So that would mean that the second socket there is not an outgoing connection, it is a incoming connection spawned off the listen. How do we check that? Socket.socket. Is there an is listening? Probably not. There is a way to poll if something is actually a... Well, it's not going to be a... it'd be an incoming versus outgoing, but there's no real distinction between incoming versus outgoing. I guess it'd be... Oh, you know how I can determine it? The port number, because... The sender uses the base port and the receiver uses the base port plus 1 from memory. So we can look at the local address and we can look at the peer address. So we need to take a look at the port here and just confirm that. So the receiver uses plus 1 and the sender uses plus 0. Epic Man, test serialization sender. Where are we at? We're here. We want to look at the sockets, which was items. And if we have a look at that, sender. Okay, so we know this is the listen one because socket.accept, and that's the base address, 7702. And we have the local address as 7702. Can I get the remote address? I probably can. And we'll get that in a sec, but because those two match, we know this accept spawned this one here. And if we have a look at the file descriptor, FD7, or actually can we? Maybe I've got this wrong. FD7, file object. I actually need to be pretty printing this. Except this is a representation, not the string, so it's not going to pretty print correctly. But we'll try it anyway. Pretty prints. Okay, so there's actually only one item in this queue, and it's a listen. So we're getting stuck on listening. So you know what that means? I might actually have blocking code in here. No, I can't because it's blocking on selector. And the other weird thing is I'm pretty sure if we have a look at our main loop and we have a look at the next tick. So let's do a long list. Next, what was next tick stuck set to? 1. So 1 second. Block. So that means there's no runnable tasks, which is correct because that one was blocking on that. No, you know what? Yeah, we only have 1 task running. Interesting. Very, very, very interesting. I think this is one of those ones I'm going to have to go away and think about. I'm actually going to finish up here because I have to think about dinner very, very shortly. But I'm trying to stream around 3 o'clock onwards every single day, and hopefully I'm going to be able to go for 4 hours in the future. But thanks for joining me. I enjoyed the conversation, 101. I hope to see you around sometime in the future. And hopefully next time I'm on, I'll have made some progress on this specific issue. I think I'm going to have to go off and rewrite parts of this just to align all the APIs and just make it a bit cleaner so it can actually be debugged. Thanks for the follow there as well. Hope to join you soon. And as I said, between 3 onwards, hopefully we can make a bit more progress next time. So see you all later. Goodbye.